And welcome to this video.
Hi, T.
My name is T. If you're new here, I really do hope everyone's safe.
T talks like a soft woman. She talks with that voice too. She got that breathy voice. That breathy voice. Aaron says, Brittany, what was the type of music during the break? Well, I originally had my friend's music up, but I think it switched to a different thing. So when I exited out, I was like, oh, I don't know what that is. So I don't know what it was.
Day is going well.
Okay, we cannot pause this video too much, so let's just go.
Let me tell you a little story.
In my freshman year of college, I had sex for the very first time. I would say I lost my virginity, but as the saying goes, I didn't lose a damn thing. I know exactly where I put it. Some may say that once the act is done for the first time, the rest is smooth sailing. Oh, but on the contrary.
For some reason, I felt stuck. So on one hand, I was lit as fuck.
What?
I was really feeling myself. Not necessarily because my first sexual encounter was just, oh, so impressive. Hell no. But because of what it represented, I had finally done the thing. The big momentous thing that I had thought about and anticipated for so long. And as I started to get more comfortable exploring with new partners, learning what I liked and what I didn't, I knew that this thing would change the trajectory of my adulthood. And it did. I have sat before this camera, looking many different ways, sharing many different thoughts. But the constant is obvious. Before I am anything else, I am a Black woman and a proud sexual being. But I'm getting ahead of myself. So back to college. Okay. Why the hell did I still feel so stuck?
Oh, but on the contrary. At the courtesy of puritanical teachings and, of course, the patriarchy, I was immediately tasked with the burden of balancing my sexual inclinations against social condemnations. How could I live in the fullness of my sexuality when I struggled to accept it as an actual part of my humanity in the first place? As I furthered in this battle internally, on the outside world, female sexuality was having a renaissance. Movies, shows, music, especially music. Everywhere I looked, I was reminded that
I'm sorry to pause it. Oh my gosh, but Nicki Minaj just put out the new song and it's a total banger and I really love it and it's really, really good and it's like totally up my alley.
This particular organ at the intersection of my thighs was powerful, magical even. It could move mountains. It could evoke emotions. It could inspire change. Gone were the days of disconnection from my own body. Sexual purpose and possibility were up to me.
I'm sorry, this is different, right? T's videos are not normally like video essays. Is she turning into a... Have I not watched her in a while? Might have been a second, but I swear, didn't I just watch... I watched her like every 5 months.
To decide.
So it's not too often.
Goodbye, shame-riddled vagina. Usher in the all-powerful pussy.
Yeah, baby. Let's go, mama.
Or, let's go. Today... The P. In its redefined image, performance, and functionality, I was invited to join in on the fun and shed any negativity, any insecurity,
is that becoming Mary Jane?
Any ounce of confusion.
No, she has a piercing. Oh, this is, oh, that's a really good show. Fuck, she's a painter. Her name is Nora.
Between
that's a good
legs.
Show.
Sex.
That's a good show.
Especially when had or spoken of frequently and explicitly, was no longer just an activity. It was liberation. Or was it?
She's gotta have it? Is that what it's called? She's gotta have it? On Netflix?
For me, Nicki Minaj is revival in pink hair and Barbie chains. She solidified her place in hip-hop,
love
in
Nicki.
Part because she gave us Black femininity in its multifaceted glory at a time where being a Black woman who is equal parts animated, colorful, serious, and sexual was practically unheard of. Certainly not very well respected. Nicki's work brought me constant reminders of a woman's ability to view her sex appeal as a powerful instrument that, if utilized, could get her anything she wants.
Nicki does not make music for men. Nicki makes music for women. That's the point, though. Women, even me, guys, like, I love the men in my audience so fucking much. They're so great. But, like, I assume the average guy probably doesn't want to hear what I have to say necessarily, right? Like, look at how Destiny's audience, like, kind of reacts, and I understand that, but I get it because when I did my copywriting for this business, I said, well, who do I want to talk to? I want to talk to women in their 30s and 40s and people who are like, you know, getting some grounding and people who are moving forward. And the reason for that is because then we could be like more like badass bitches, right? Because like when I was younger and making content, it was like neurotic 20-year-olds, like all of us were a mess. But now I'm hoping, and my analytics reflects that we're growing out of our adolescence and our neuroticism into stability and foundation and working hard. And Nikki kind of gives me that energy. When I listen to Nikki or Cardi or any of those people, Meg Thee Stallion, anybody, I'm getting like this Beyonce, like I'm getting this really strong sense of like, this is for women. Like it's not in a feministy way, but like in a, this is our life. Like no matter what we do, strength is found in our sexuality if we are those types of women. And I am that type of woman. I like being naked. I like putting my body out there. So I needed role models who put their body out there, but were also just as skilled as the male counterparts they had or any other people in their competition. And Nikki is amazing at what she does. Beyonce is amazing. Meg is great. They're all so talented. It makes me feel reassured that I can be sexy and strong because that is the mode of being that I actually prefer to be in, which is why I like BDSM as well. Because it's very like sexual, but very like not. It's like your skill matters. If you can throw a whip, you are more important in the dungeon than if you're sexy. But because throwing a whip is so difficult, the skill is what you're being praised for, and you're sexy on top of that. Like, what's hotter than a person who's skilled in their art and is sexy? It's like, ma'am. Like, so that's my goal. My goal is to be good at my job, to be a smart person, and to keep in shape and be sexy. And I know my arms are shit right now. You just give me a second. I'm gonna start getting into it. I have my appointment with my nutritionist today, bitch. Okay? We're almost there.
You wanted, including loyalty, status, and of course, money. So I'm sure you can understand my disappointment when she interviewed with Elle Magazine and expressed judgment towards women who have sex for materialism or any sort of profit.
What, Nikki? My anaconda what? My anaconda, what you say?
For me, Megan Thee Stallion is true to this, not new to this exhibition. Ooh. In leotards and cowboy hats.
Meg is like
she
so
fucking
hot.
She is a refreshing force who, despite the world's constant attempts to defeminize and shame her for her unambiguous features, will stop at nothing to drill it into our minds that when it comes to her sexuality, outside opinions ain't stopping a damn thing. If the category is sex, you better believe Megan Thee Stallion is bringing extreme skill and experience to the table. So I'm sure you could understand my heartbreak when she got on Hot 97 and chose to distance herself from the same promiscuity she totes in her music. Ooh. Reassuring viewers that she hasn't had that many sexual partners because she gotta keep the mileage low. Cardi B, oh my goodness. For me, Cardi B is a self-made, fun-filled firecracker in AP bustdowns and 6-inch acrylics. She came in the game with a clear message. She's never gonna fake who she is, and she is always gonna uplift those around her, especially other women. So I'm sure you can understand my confusion when she, like many female rappers, make music that consistently feeds into a competitive, girl fight narrative. Who's the prettiest? Who's the richest? Who's the sexiest?
It's because that competition is sexy. It gets you wet. Like, there's something about it that's really fucking hot. Like, there's something really hot about it. I can't call Destiny right now. Tell him to be better at streaming. I'm watching women be women. Maybe I'll get in my women mode and I'll call him, but I can't. I have to go talk to my nutritionist. I can't keep pausing this video. I'm gonna be late for my appointment.
Let me say this loud and clear. The mere gumption of these hypersexual performers to constantly defy sexual repression by existing in ways that Black women especially have been denied and even socially prosecuted for. It's audacious.
Audacious.
It's artful. It's invigorating. It's the reason why I'm sitting here in this
stiffy ass, itchy ass wig to begin with.
And as a consumer.
Also, yeah, did y'all see Meg Thee Stallion on Hulk? She-Hulk? Yeah, I did. I thought it was cute, but I like Meg.
That is freeing just to witness. But when I truly examine the set of rules that the hypersexual market requires in order to thrive, when I truly examine the do's and don'ts, the whys and the why nots, I find a lot of polarity. Dare I say, hypocrisy. I find a veneer of liberation, absolutely. A very polished and convincing veneer. But a nucleus of some values that are pretty damn ancient, and if left undecorated, could be seen as the total opposite of liberation. I swear, it was just 2010 when I thought pink wigs and thick ass was gonna save the planet and ultimately redefine feminism as we knew it. And in some ways, a little thing has been done. Yeah. But as I further in this work, and I am reminded all the time that everything requires nuance, anything is eligible for a re-examination. At this moment in time right now, today, I'm not so sure. Part of the reason why sexual liberation is as exciting of a movement and a topic as it is because it feels good to feel fucking good.
Yes, it does, girl, but also this wig. Interesting. Love this color, love pastels. Y'all need to stop spamming my chat. I know Destiny's not crying, and I know Molina did not dump him. Stop spamming my chat. I'm not going to call him. I want to finish this video.
Y'all know I am a huge advocate for self-pleasure and exploration, which is why I'm so happy this portion of today's video.
Wait, I'm sorry. This moves really along with the objectification. Nikki, Beyonce, Britney, all these people who like make their money off objectifying their own bodies. And then they're like, men shouldn't objectify us. Yes, ladies, I hear you. Internally, I fucking hate it and I keep notes. What man is around you and can't figure out how not to objectify you when he's talking to you? Right? I get you. Just like move those guys, swipe left, bitch. You know, because it's just going to be those people, men or women. It's like the women, Anita Blake, Laura K. Hamilton wrote this whole series. And Anita's character is like constantly triggered because she's from the 80s about other women shaming her for being slutty. Even though Anita isn't like slutty in the same way like other sluts are, she's like slutty. Like in the same way I'm slutty, but not slutty like other women are. Like, yeah, some women are like full on hoe bags. They'll sleep with your man. They'll cheat. They'll do all these things. They're fucking cunts. But okay, that's a variation of unhealthy sluttiness. Whatever. Then this variation of consent-based sluttiness, which is different, and it adds a different energy into the mix. Also, at what point are we all just like together? Because honestly, in my head, if I was sitting next to Nikki, I'd be like, what up? We're like the same. She'd be like, what do you mean we're the same? Are you like a top tier rapper? I'm like, no. And she goes, what are you top tier at? I was like, existing? What are you top tier at? She'd be like, rapping. I'm like, great. We're both top tier at something. We're the same. Like, I don't really like believe in this idea. But like when women are together, like Nikki and Cardi and Beyonce, and they're like all together in their spheres. Like Beyonce, I always wonder in her head if she resents the world for not making her a billionaire the way they did to Jay. Like they made Jay-Z a billionaire, but Jay-Z made himself a billionaire. But like men, they congregate differently than women. Women, we just started being like, are we pro-women? And it's like, yeah, I guess we'll be like each other's friends. But at the same time, I think there is a healthy sense of competition. Like there are some women out there that I just will not trust. I will not talk to, and I don't want to be their friend. There's a reason I like my relationships with Kyla and Melina, because I feel like they're normal. And even though they're weird, like nothing bad, too bad is going to happen from that relationship. The other feministy female friends I had in my life betrayed me, ghosted me, spread rumors about me. Fuck you, Lindsay Ellis. You can suck my dick. Sorry, you can suck my big clit. Like, all these women who claim they're pro-women are the first ones to spread rumors about you and talk shit and won't even fight you in public about it. Girl, I'll pull your hair right now.
This video is sponsored yet again by Laylo. We're talking about a couple celebrities in today's video, but this... This
yes,
is the
girl.
All new Eat Away,
I need to buy some toys. Massager
created
some toys
for the curious and adventurous pleasure seekers out there. Eat Away is so cool. It uses wave motion technology that mimics a finger-like motion. This little insertable tail moves in circular motions to work with the rest of the toy to bring stimulation to other areas. And as you can see, it's super... As you can see, it's super flexible and adjustable for a range of body types.
Let's go, man.
I'm
gonna buy that.
Wearable,
I'm gonna buy that.
Hands-free product.
Right,
you can tap into the hands-free experience through the Laylo app, where four additional settings can be configured and customized to your personal liking. Eat Away is all about sensual independence, and Laylo has actually created a declaration of sensual independence. And I would like to add a principle. Let your pleasure inspire you. For me,
you guys
the best
see this
part about self-intimacy is there's no pressure. No pressure to flex, no pressure to impress, but all of the freedom to shamelessly lean into my desires. And even though my self-intimacy is private, I still want to challenge myself to channel that feeling of liberty and use it to inspire other areas of my life. The Eat Away has been a brilliant instrument in helping me with that, and I highly recommend it for pleasure seekers who want the same.
Right now.
So check it out, click the link in my description or follow the link.
Oh, it is not cheap, girl.
And of course, Thank you to Layla for sponsoring this portion
cute
of today's video.
Pictures, the one. All the pictures are really cute.
The P word. An elusive etymology. The composition of the hypersexual Black woman performer is simple. She is young, a median age of late 20s, but no older than 40. Her body is either surgically modified or naturally proportioned in a way that appeals to the Black male gaze. Perky breasts, a small waist, and a fat ass. Equally visible from the front as it is from the back. Her fashion is flamboyant and largely influenced by Black sex worker aesthetics. With hair colorful and bold enough to light up a room, heels high enough to trample on the soles of her enemies, and nails long enough to cut a bitch if they dare try to cross her. The title of bad bitch is not only deserved, it's practically a birthright. The image of her lifestyle signifies opulence, indulgence, shameless excessiveness, and extreme consumerism. Her demeanor is confident, her personality intriguing, but most of all, she fearlessly and tirelessly defends her position in the hypersexual market. And her most powerful weapon is not the money, the cars, or the clothes. It's her language.
Oh, language. Interesting. Jessica says, there are genuine, sincere women who want to uplift us. Then there are sneaky, jealous women who want to steal your personality. And I swear, shit scares me. Bro, literally, the worst betrayal I've ever had in my life have always come from women. Like, that's what I'm saying. We have enough fucking PTSD with other women. We know. We know what they're fucking capable of. And at the same time, I was raped by men. So, like, you know what I mean? Backstabbing, like, demoralizing, bullying, like, getting kicked out of blah, 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 blah. Rape. It's like, you are all fucking useless. I hate you all. Oh, that's, what's her name? Oh, how does she play this without getting copyrighted?
The P word has been a descriptor for many different things, ranging from cat to coward to vulva. Merriam-Webster's second of four definitions for this word is vulgar usage. Noun, vulva, sexual intercourse, or the female partner in sexual intercourse. Okay. If you were to tell me to define the P word, I would have guessed vulva. Absolutely, certainly. Maybe sexual intercourse, but a female partner? In sexual intercourse? I think not. Because we typically don't use the P word and woman interchangeably. Or do we? As we know, it's very common for someone to say something like, tonight, I'm getting some money. Instead of, tonight, I am having sex with a woman. Or I am having sex with someone with a vagina. Now granted, they don't roll off the tongue the same way, right? One word signifies the presence of ego, the desire to be deemed impressive, while the other, not so much. But I believe the reason why we don't say we are having sex with blank is because that's not actually what's happening. And the word pussy is meant to signify that. In this context, sex is not being had with a woman or a person. A whole person comprised of eyes, a nose, a mouth, and a full range of emotions. But rather, a device of sorts, completely untethered from human form. It is truly an object of imagination with, as we'll discuss today, an image, functionality, and importance that in very few ways resembles that of what could ever belong to an actual human being. Now, while I have thoughts on the questionable life force that the P has taken on, I will say that bringing that word to the forefront of modern English language was the exact confrontation that some of these motherfuckers needed. Because whether we are talking about it in actuality or in imagination, it's still an obsession. Wars have been started, laws have been made, in our lifetime, human rights have been stripped away, all because of the obsession with it. Yet everybody wanna keep it on the hush. So in a way, these hypersexual performers constantly saying the word can be seen as a confrontation, of that obsession. That's the exact way I interpreted the message of Megan Thee Stallion's Thought Shit video. Let's talk about that video actually, because I didn't, they didn't hear from, the streets did not hear from me the way they should have when the video initially dropped. So let's spin the block again. Okay. She begins it by introducing a white man who is a senator. So in America, at least, there's only a couple dozen seats ahead of him before he is literally one of the most powerful people on earth. And I love how subtly she highlighted this irony, because I remember when the song WAP dropped with Cardi B, and there were literal politicians giving their two cents about it on Twitter. Again, some of the most powerful people in the country, arguably the world, chasing fucking clout.
Bubbles!
And better yet, on Bubbles. The same website where people have daily arguments over whether or not pineapple belongs on pizza. Back to the video. The senator is taking time out of his day at the office to not only consume and thus passively support Megan's music video, but in order to soothe himself for the fact that he is helping keep the lights on at the hot girl headquarters, whether he like it or not, he decides to leave a hate comment. How original. And once that's done, he unzips his pants to commence that same thing with the Wayne Schling, you know what I'm saying? And then Meg calls him up and she's like, look, motherfucker, these regressive whores you're trying to step on are actually the people you depend on. Now, the way I interpreted that was, it's not just Megan, the rapper with her ass out. It's sanitation engineers, garbage truck drivers, and as we saw throughout the video, waitresses, secretaries, nurses, doctors. They are all sexual beings in their own way, all free to express that however they choose or don't. So yeah, it was definitely nice to see Megan reiterate a point that we have been making for like, ever. That was nice. And this video was especially cool because it seemed like...
How do my, I'm keep muting my volume because my brother's vacuuming, but okay. How did my asexual, demisexual people feel about this? Like, do you think we're overcorrecting even with T's language now? Do you feel like she's overcorrecting where she's like, we're all sexual beings, but like, are we? Because I don't think we are. You know what I mean? Like, I like the idea that like all of us are like sexual. Like, I even talked to my priest friend about this, how he says, like, one time I was explaining the levels to him and we were talking and he goes, Brittany, if God isn't real, then I want to be married and have kids, but God's real. And I was like, mm-hmm. And he's like, he's real. And I was like, mm-hmm. And then we looked at each other and we were like, mm-hmm. And he's like, because if it's not real, I should be a dad. And I was like, mm-hmm. And like, we're looking at each other and I'm like, you know what I mean? Because he's, it's weird because he likes me so much and he does respect my ideas, but like, I don't really want to take him away from like the Catholic Church. And I don't think I could. I think his faith is really, really strong. But even the idea that like he was looking at me, he's like, you know something I don't know? And I was like, no, I don't know nothing. And I still don't. I don't know if God's real. I have no idea. It's the same. I don't know. I feel like people look at me sometimes like, do you know something I don't? I'm like, I don't know. I just know that there's something in the language that I'm hearing from all, like from like even T right now where I'm like, I get it. But I also think like people think they're really important and they don't even exercise that importance. You know, like when Megan tells the white guy to like, hey, like we're the ones. That would only be true if we actually utilized our power, but we often don't. And people don't want to. People want other people to, like, take care of them. That's why this whole world works the way it does, right? I don't know. I didn't like the language here, but it's okay. I just wanted to pose the question. Do you feel like it's overcorrection that everyone is a sexual person? Because I don't think that. I think everyone's just uniquely themselves.
It took place in the 90s, maybe the 80s? I'm not sure. This video taking place in prior decades also signifies that this is nothing new. All this sex, nothing new.
It ain't
sometimes
new.
Older generations try to make it seem like we are just a special kind of obscene and indecent.
Oh my goodness, have you heard what's on the radio lately? Oh my gosh, have you seen what the young women are wearing lately? This generation is so sex obsessed. What about the kids?
Bruh, what about them fucking kids? What always gets me is the sex obsessed part, because actually, based on studies done in the past 5 years, Gen Z and millennials are having record less sex than prior generations. And this is for a number of factors. One being, we just got other shit to do. Julesy said, have you ever looked at a family tree and seen how people were just mass producing children like factories? It's because they were bored and they had nothing better to do but fuck. Because rent is high. Discussion of sex, however, has seen a dramatic increase in younger generations. But just because we're talking more about sex, even with increasing vulgarity, doesn't mean that it's a newer version. It's the same old activity, just new norms and newer forms of expression.
Amen, girl. It's a cycle.
One of those many forms being music. Now, yes, when girl. It comes to language,
it's a cycle.
I am not critical of the confrontational, unfiltered aspect of things. Like, no, never me gonna be critical about why saying the bad words feels so damn good. Come on now. I am critical because we have the power to take it even further. We have the power to say, okay, now that we've caused some discomfort with our language, now that we've stirred the pot, we can also examine how that same language affects us in real life. Like, outside of the music videos, outside of Twitter. And here's where we can shift the spotlight away from the word pee and use just about anything that has gone from offensive to empowering. Take the reclamation of words like bitch or hoe, for example. Those are words that, even outside of music, can be used interpersonally as terms of endearment. And while I'm happy that we can jokingly call each other bitch, does that reclamation change the fact that negatively or positively, bitch and hoe are gendered terms aimed at women? Does it change the fact that a woman's demeanor or her sex life is tied to her character? And depending on who that offends, can risk her reputation, her job, her motherhood? Does it allow women the grace to still be imperfect individuals? Are the bitches and hoes of real life being taken seriously if and when their rights are violated? Or are they considered too indecent to be victims? I wonder if the reason these questions aren't addressed in the same spaces where we so loudly and proudly call this stuff feminism is because that would then require us to step out of the hypersexual, hyper-capitalist fantasy. And that's just not cute enough. See, because that sounds like the angry, insufferable, hairy armpit feminism. And that's not what y'all signed up for, right? It's okay. This is a safe space. Y'all signed up for the bad bitch, boss bitch, all about her money feminism. And you see all of this nuance, all of this conversation, it's just not giving that. Sometimes it feels like we are so desperate to justify the things that makes us feel good as women that we will try to bend and mold feminism or other movements of gender equity so that it works for us. Like, we want feminism to come to us rather than joining the movement. What I'm getting at is,
ooh, just like a woman, wait for someone else to do the work and seek the benefits.
Just because something badass is happening involving women, especially involving our sexuality, it doesn't automatically make it a liberating political movement. It doesn't automatically make it regressive either, but what it does make it is something that deserves nuance. Certainly something that deserves an honest assessment of who it benefits and who it does not. Chapter 2, The Feminist Gaze and the Liberation Masquerade. Khadijah and Bo did a video a couple weeks ago called, Are We Turning Away?
I want to watch this next. Well, I can't watch it today, but I want to watch this.
Sex positive feminism. Take a look at what they have to say.
For example, I love Beyonce down, right?
Yeah.
I'm a Beyonce apologist.
Of course.
She's my billionaire anti-capitalist
Relatable.
Queen. I'm a Beyonce. Leave me
100%.
Alone. I know. Okay, I know.
100%.
When Bell Hooks called her a terrorist, I was like, girl, I hadn't read Bell Hooks like that at that time, so I was like, I don't know if I want to read this author. No, Beyonce's not a terrorist. She's getting freaky. She's letting the girls get freaky and talking about feminism. We can do both and be a girl boss. Hey. But thinking back on it, I wouldn't have used the word terrorist, but I understand more now what Hooks meant as best I can. And now it's more so she was seeing what a lot of us couldn't see at the time and are seeing now, which is the women that are peddling this brand of feminism that are like the Beyoncés, or even maybe not as wealthy as Beyoncé, maybe just like the Megan Thee Stallions. They can afford still to have security. They can afford to live in a gated area. They're not walking down the street with their keys between their fingers for fear that somebody's gonna try it. That's because they're wearing pum-pum shorts because it's 48 degrees outside, Celsius.
Pum-pum shorts were a great example because I would consider those relatively casual attire that can be worn because they're cute and or, like Khadijah said, because it's hot outside. But even that simple attire could be predatorily mistaken as a sexual invitation, even if that's not the type of timing you want. We can also take it a step further and speak to not just the average person's version of revealing clothing, but the exact attire that someone like a Beyonce or a Megan Thee Stallion would wear on stage or in a music video. We can talk about the black femmes who dress in that exact same attire, sometimes in even more revealing attire, who actually are looking for sexual attention. Like maybe sex workers? You see, this didn't just start with hypersexual performers. The costuming of sex work attire has...
Beyonce has to be sexy and look sexy because aren't the women who are watching her also imagining that they are that sexy? Like, it's not just like the men, because some people might say like, oh, these women are trying to look sexy for the male gaze, but aren't they also trying to be sexy for us? So we can feel like we are living vicariously through them, just like Andrew Tate stays in shape. So men can be like, I want to look like Andrew Tate, bro. I want to have a six-pack ab. I want to look like Joe Rogan. I want to look like a man with muscles. Whatever men are like aspiring in those bubbles, of course, in those specific bubbles, they're like aspiring for, right? Hi, Maddox. Isn't T just, well, not T, but like Khadijah or even like the Beyonce comment, aren't those women also trying to look the sexy way that we want to look in some ways, or at least me, like my bestie, she does not listen to any of these people. She likes Ella Fitzgerald and the 40s, 50s, 30s music. She likes like classy women and Audrey Hepburn. She thinks like she wants a man who's like James Bond. I want a man who like watches anime. Do you understand the differences here? Like, sexy is different for all of us, like what we're attracted to, but like I am into that girl boss energy. But like my bestie, who's more of a traditional Democrat feminist, like is not. She's much more into the, we should have master's degrees and dress like women and not be hoes. And I'm like, let's just be hoes. Like, let's just be like loud and obnoxious and do drugs. Right? Like totally different kinds of women. I obviously dominate more and make more money because I'm in my masculine. Thank you. But like, you know, it is what it is, ladies. Maybe that's it too. Maybe I don't want the other kind of feminism because y'all are poor.
Has had the fashion industry in a chokehold for at least the past few decades.
Notably, Versace's 1992 fall collection titled Miss S&M showcased pieces inspired by real-life dominatrixes.
That's what I'm saying, y'all. High-end fashion, all BDSM. All these people are BDSM and they don't want to say it. All of them are fucking their secretaries. They don't want to talk about it. That's what I'm saying. All of these bubbles that you guys are all obsessed with, like, oh, why is it bad? They're all doing it. That's the whole point. Everyone's fucking doing it. I don't know why y'all are stressing out about your lives, except that it actually comes down on the regular person the most. That's what I'm saying. Rich people have been doing BDSM shit. Rihanna is definitely in BDSM. You think Nicki's not in BDSM? She has a whole music video with her and fucking Drake. Like, that's what I'm saying. All these people have BDSM elements. FKA Twigs, definitely 100% a BDSMer. She, like, has a professional rigger who comes onto her music videos and fucking does her hair and shit, like, with rope. Like, don't fucking tell me these people don't have connections to, like, the BDSM world. It's not just normie, Midwest, like, Americans doing it. When I traveled internationally to Belize, like, people literally were hitting me up, like, yo, we have, like, places here to do BDSM. You want to come? And I was like, holy shit. So, like, again, that's what popped some of my first bubbles, where I was like, hey, all these, like, normie people that we praise and give billions of dollars to, they're doing BDSM shit. So why the fuck are the furries on Discord getting bullied? But now, that's not happening, right? Because people are actually outing themselves, and we're talking about it more. Fuck the world. Fuck the world, and fuck all of you for falling for it again and again and again and again. Because it's all us. We keep allowing, like, these people to pretend we're not doing things. And I like it. I like looking like a normie, and then in the privacy of my house being totally wild. I love that too. But let me tell you right now, the dungeon is full of fucking conservatives and libertarians. The conservatives love BDSM.
Which are still being worn by big stars of today.
And when we talk about more accessible fashion, fast fashion brands such as Fashion Nova and Shein have built empires off aesthetics that resemble those of femmes in the erotic workplace.
True.
We know this. But did you also know that according to growjo.com, these two brands alone gross a combined estimated revenue of over $990 million per year? Now let me ask you, how much of that do you think has trickled down to your local stripper or escort? How much of that do you think?
No. T, you gotta see it. You gotta see it for what it is. No, you're looking. No, wrong. It's not up to down to up. It is across. Poor people who do BDSM and rich people who do BDSM, elites who do BDSM and normal people who do BDSM, we're all the fucking same. We're humans who do BDSM. We just do it differently and experience it differently. Like, even classism plays this role in BDSM. But, like, again, the elites aren't punishing us because we're doing BDSM. They are punishing us because we're asking them, because we're masochists, to punish us for not being good little Christians. Like, it's not that. The populace that is... The Vatican is having butt-fucking parties. parties with cocaine right now, and we are not invited because they're haters. We should be in the Vatican fucking priests along with them, but instead, the priests are all having gay fucking orgies without the kids. I don't want the kid ones. Just the adult ones are having coke-fueled, ass-snorting fucking licking parties, and we're not invited because we keep telling them that they should be celibate and pious because in secret we want to have our kinks. We are telling our leaders to shame us for doing what they're doing and we're doing. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying we are the problem because we are the masses. We have the numbers. And if we stop shaming each other, right, then they would be like, oh yeah, we're all kinky too. Cool? Cool. But we wouldn't be with each other. We'd just be all kinky and out with it. It just, it's all under the fucking radar because we want it to be. Do you get what I'm saying? Our bubbles want it to be. How many Muslim communities do I have to fucking, like, learn about? All those people are kinky as fuck, some of them. And they don't talk about it because they're not supposed to because of, like, religion. So again, I don't think it's top to bottom, bottom to top. We are all the fucking same. And we're all lying to each other. We're all lying to everyone, especially ourselves, about how sexually free we want to be. And it's fine. I also don't want to talk to my parents about how I eat ass, right? Like, this is not a conversation I want to have with my parents. But goddamn, right? If I'm not watching my friends get on Fresh and Fit and have fucking basic conversations about whether Destiny's a cuck for sucking dick or letting Melina fuck other people, right? But we're all fucking doing it. Myron is doing it. All these men are doing it. They've been caught in DMs. People have talked about it before. I don't know why the fuck we're still in denial, except we live in bubbles and we have cognitive dissonance and we don't want to admit that we are the reason. So I'm sorry, T, go ahead.
Link has traveled from Hidden Hills, where all these rich people be at, to the corners of Skid Row. When this fashion, which at one point sex workers were arrested for, is put in the hands of celebrities who are protected.
Because we keep wanting to be arrested for it.
Protected by their wealth and their class. What is it doing for the women and femmes of whom they've drawn their inspiration from? Is their safety now being ensured? And again, while the sight of one of our favorite celebrities wearing that attire does a lot on the fronts of visibility and confrontation, similar to language, does that confrontation do anything for the people who need it the most? Genuinely ask yourself.
I think everyone needs it the most. From rich to poor, to elite to nobody, everybody needs to have a good, healthy conversation about kink and consent, right? I don't think it's us versus them. This us versus us, them narrative makes it like we are not like them. They are me, I am them, bitch. Nicki Minaj is not better than me just because she's Nicki Minaj. No one is better than me just because they're famous or rich or elite or whatever. They're the same as me. How did I get my freedom and voice as a woman and her sexuality? I demanded it. And I will maintain that demand. I will not stop maintaining that demand. But then you have to find your bubble where you thrive and, like, who fucks with you, right? Because you just know, okay, you just know that conservative communities are not going to publicly want to admit that these things are happening. And at the same time, I don't even know liberal ones that want to do it. Like, a lot of people don't want to talk about these things. I mean, can we really expect people to be out and open about their kinkiness or have the elites care or give a fuck about anything when we don't even give a fuck? Look at Destiny and all these people, like Fresh and Fit and Sneeko and everybody, still debating on whether or not women should get, like, how educated should a woman be? I'm just like, ma'am, we are purposely distracting ourselves with the most shallow conversations because the answer is not one anyone likes, which is we don't know what we're doing. It's all a fucking construct and we're doing our best. But, like, this is us. We did this to ourselves.
Is slut shaming decreasing? Not just in how we spew it out to others, but how we harbor it internally. Or is it still considered perfectly normal for these performers to be bragging about their sexual aptitude in one breath, while protecting a reputation of angelic purity or, in the very least, shaming women who don't, in the other? As mentioned by Gigi Fong in a writing called Sex Work and Fashion Are More Closely Linked Than You'd Think,
of course,
quote, many staples of sex workers' lifestyle have been appropriated for fashion, so much so that many don't even think or know to credit sex workers. One of these objects are pleaser shoes, a brand of heels that cater to strippers. A symbol of eroticism, this style of footwear fully supports the ankle and feet, allowing strippers to climb poles and do floor work safely.
Rapper Saweetie is one of Pleaser's celebrity fans and has worn the brand's towering silhouettes on several occasions to elevate her outfits. It is jarring then that in her song My Type, the artist seemingly distances herself from women who perform sex work. Quote, you the type that's fucking for the rent. You with that. End quote.
This has always been an especially sore spot for me, and if you've been watching this channel for like at least two and a half years, you know. I had a video discussing this exact same thing. Would you believe that video was like 8 minutes long? What, like, sweetie, what surface was you cracking? Come on now. Anyway, this whole promiscuously modest, oxymoronic image that these hypersexual performers cling to for dear life, it pisses me off. Because be fucking for real. Why don't we just be honest and say, in the hypersexual market, it is safer for women, especially heterosexual women, to oscillate through this vulgar virgin pendulum because it allows them the grace to cause men just enough discomfort so that they feel empowered as women, while still aligning close enough with male values so that they don't die without a husband. I stand pretty firm in these thoughts, not only because they've been supported through observation, but of course, as always, through past personal experience.
That was so relatable though. That was so relatable. That was so funny.
How many times I've...
And again, bubbles. So like some of us like aren't like different journeys in relation to our womanhood. You know how Lav was like, being a woman on the internet sucks. Yeah, totally. Sucks balls, bro. But like it sucks everywhere to be any kind of human anyway. So it's like, what bubble are you in and what's the hardest like thing to overcome? This is tease and I relate a lot to this.
From the men I've dated, from men in my comments.
Good luck getting a husband with that mouth.
Because first of all, who gonna tell him? A husband. Don't ever threaten me like that ever again. Women's self-respect is a threat to male structural power. I didn't just come up with that. This is like known information, I hope. I wish that as consumers, women especially, we would recognize that yes, we are doing something that makes us happy, collectively at that. But aside from what's at the forefront, the costumes, the language, hardly any revolution has been made. We're kind of at a standstill. But here's where it gets even better. Oh my gosh. That's okay. It's okay that we're at a standstill. Why? Because women's joy does not have to be revolutionary. It does not have to be political. It likely will be, but in this spot that we're stuck in, it's not due to the language or the outfits. It's not that all of that extremity is setting us back. It's the intention behind it and our inability to critically analyze that for fear of losing it. It's almost like if we can't write think pieces and make video essays about the bigger picture of singing about wet ass pussy, then somehow we're not allowed to have that kind of music and we're not allowed to feel good when we listen to it. And that's just not true. Women's enjoyment, collectively or individually, does not have to be political to deserve space in this world.
You don't like my music says men might want to have sex with these women, but they understand that they are not partner material. None of that makes sense to my brain and it's stupid. Because in my bubble, again, a woman who can't have sex, doesn't know how to control her body, can't pop her pussy, like what good are you? What good are you if you can't pop your pussy? What good are you if you can't get on top? What good are you if you can't fuck your partner until they're begging you to let them finish? Like what good are you, right? So I don't even understand this conversation around like these women aren't like partner material. Maybe for your type of partnership, yes. But you wouldn't be the type of partner for these people. Like, what am I gonna do with a Midwest suburban mom who's never touched her own clit? Like, what am I supposed to do with this? As a partner, this would not be my partner. Like, my mom and dad will say to me, like, find a man who respects you and doesn't watch porn. And I'm like, does hentai count as porn? Because I kind of need my person to want to watch hentai. Like, I kind of need this in my life. And like, my parents wouldn't even know what hentai was. But I don't even understand this conversation at all. Right? Because like, again, the thing of these men being like, these women don't even make good wives. They are your wives. They are your wives. They are your wives. And your wives are, some of them want these fantasies, want to be these women. And they're not given space. So they die. And at 99 years old on their deathbed, they're like, I should have popped my pussy. But they didn't. And it's fine. Not everyone wants to pop their pussy. But if you're the kind of girl in the specific category or the kind of person in this category, this is why I hang out with BDSMers, y'all. Because they are not fazed by your desires. They're like, cool, great, love it, do that. Be consensual, have fun, right?
But I'm gonna keep going because it gets so much worse. We talked about the contradictions in costuming and language, but also in the hypersexual market, how women approach sex as a general concept, just in general, how it is meant to feel, who does what, who deserves to be in an advantage and why, also draws direct influence from the male gaze. That dick don't run me. You better get on your knees and eat this pussy right. We toss niggas around, we treat these niggas like they beanbags. Good boy, got them on deck. Good boy, tell that nigga fetch eye. I felt this way for a while, but I'm glad.
Yo, Hayda says, she says virgins are unfuckable. No. Virgins are not unfuckable. Virgins are very fuckable. Virgins are my favorite. Babies, line up. Mommy will show you how it's done. But I'm not gonna fuck somebody who's a virgin and is afraid of their own body in such a way that they're gonna turn around and accuse me of assaulting them because I blow their mind so hard they feel like, I don't even know what happened. I'm on a different planet. Yeah, I know, bitch. I know. I'm way too experienced at this point in my life not to even, I don't even know how to fuck a virgin, but like, I will figure it out. If you want to have your mind blown, I'll figure it out for you. But like, that's the thing. It's not that virgins are unfuckable. People who are too afraid of their own bodies scare me. People who are so disconnected from their own sexual orgasm scare me. Because it's like, how did you go 30 years without touching your own fucking clit? And if you did that, that's great. I love that for you. No judgment. But if you're asking me to fuck you, you're basically asking me to get you comfortable enough that you're not afraid of your own body. That sounds like therapy. That does not sound like a sexual partner's job.
Glad to have been
but it could be, and I'm not judging.
Introduced to work from decades ago that also supports this. In that same video, Khadija also references a writing called Casualties of the Sex War, written by Karen Durbin in 1972, in which Durbin explains that casual sex, which at that time was emerging as this new, hip approach to intimacy, was not given the sexual freedom it was supposed to give. Quote, "The fact remains, men are a necessity to heterosexual women. One sees, however, some peculiar accommodations to that heterosexuality now, primarily the stillborn attempts by women to forge these new, freer relationships with men. The old nightmarish dependence begins to go out the window as one divests oneself from the idea of marriage happily ever after. But what is taking its place? Partly, it seems, a game of imitate the oppressor. Women talk about the freedom to treat men as sex objects. This is a political and emotional dead end for a movement that in its early years spoke out strongly for preserving that humanistic sensibility which has traditionally been attributed to the so-called weaker sex. The point was not that women should become hard-nosed power seekers or cool sexual manipulators, in other words, imitation men, but rather that by insisting on their full humanity, by refusing to permit men to treat them as objects, they would force the discovery of new humane sexual relationships," end quote. Instead of this new age sex being something that allowed people, especially women, the freedom to connect with others solely on a sexual level, without having to worry that things like purity culture and ego and gender expectations would get in the way or worse, punish them, people said, or? You know what sounds way easier than that? Let's just stop acknowledging each other's humanity altogether. Let's just recognize each other as bodies, and we'll be able to avoid all of that. Again, Durbin wrote that in 1972.
Woo!
My mother wasn't even...
1972! Okay, there's actually this issue... Oh God, I gotta go soon. Okay, we gotta...
Been born
okay.
yet.
Hold on.
And we still hear similar themes in the music we're discussing today, in rap music. Especially
No, I have to do it. Okay, that one dude said, and this that statement implies that all men naturally treat women that way, and that is sexist and wrong. Yes, but it is the narrative being pushed out by, like, Andrew Tate world. So Andrew Tate, Myron world, they're pushing out this one narrative that makes men seem like the scummiest, piggiest, like, worst men, right? And then you go to a different bubble, and you're like, men are really sweet and wonderful and lovely, and, like, I really like my man, and, like, I like him a lot. But he fits into this bubble. And so, like, you look, that's what I'm saying. Like, all of our bubbles are struggling with different, like, relationships with our bodies. Again, in my conservative bubble growing up, wearing shorts like this was super scandalous. Growing up in my best friend's bubble, who lived next door to me, like, we lived in the same neighborhood bubble, but different cultural bubble. And her bubble, she was allowed to wear tank tops and shorts, and her parents would let her even show her midriff or wear a bikini. And that was allowed. Like, my mom literally told her, like, oh, you're allowed to wear a bikini in front of your dad? And then she was like, yeah. And then her parents always thought that was funny. because in my family, you don't wear bikinis in front of your brothers or your dad. And so, like, again, cultural bubbles, differences, sexuality is experienced differently. Again, Mark was watching Queer Eye with me yesterday and literally thought the woman wearing shorts couldn't be ashamed of her body because she's wearing shorts. But, like, that's not how that works, right? Like, we, not just because we don't love our bodies doesn't mean that we don't wear shorts. But in our bubble, that's exactly what you do. If you don't like your body, you cover it up. You don't show it off. And wearing shorts is showing it off. So, again, I think ultimately, past all of this conversation, past the dehumanization which occurred with this radical, like, oh, women are oppressed, let's go the other direction where we become just as shitty as, like, men, even though all men aren't like that, I think we should just examine the self. What do you want? If you were outside of your bubbles, outside of your culture, outside of the world telling you what you wanted, what do you actually want? What do you need? What do you want? What inspires you and keeps you going? Like, what is actually the point of your existence other than appealing to the bubble you were born into, which is fine, but, like, what is it really you want? If people ask themselves those questions, we'd have a much different world, and we do. It's just not done on mass scale, which is fine, because you can't force people through the journey of introspection.
Sex is rarely centered on pleasure. There's a lot of pleasure buzzwords, sure, but you will be hard-pressed to find a hip-hop song of present or past that is solely discussing sex and the act of it and how it feels without attaching it to egotism or materialism. Because the main goal isn't sex itself, it's power assumption. Come on now, hashtag be fucking for real. And we hear women in rap doing the same shit. Imitating the attitudes and values of men during sex, which again are stereotypically selfish, aggressive, power-seeking, does not guarantee women anything aside from a fleeting ego stroke. It doesn't guarantee our safety, our consideration, or orgasms. And is that not what the fuck we showed up for? Overall, I feel it's become very popular to hold these really callous attitudes towards sex.
True.
Under the guise of keeping it casual.
For sure.
Even though casual is the last thing that's happening here. You see, casual requires a regularity and a lack of concern. This shit is a thoroughly planned conquest. When a person enters a sexual situation with full intention to be selfish and seek domination, especially when that hasn't been explicitly expressed to the other parties involved, I would say the only thing casual about that is the rotation of the partners. Everything else sounds pretty methodical to me. Mm. A great example is Nicki's boss ass bitch freestyle, which at one point, nah, because that was my pledge of fucking allegiance. Do you hear me? Anyway, for those who don't know, the most iconic part of that whole song is where she enters like a rule book. The text reads, rule number one to be a boss ass bitch, never let a clown nigga try to play you. If he play you, then rule number two is fuck his best friends and make them yes men. Then get a dick pic and then you press send. And send a red heart and send a kissy face and tell him that his friends love how you taste. Are you kidding me? Like, are you joking me right now? But listen, that's not casual. That's a conquest.
Well, that's
and
a,
what about that?
That's like
aside
war.
From
that's
revenge, like, caters to her chess. Desires. Mm-hmm. What if doing something like that doesn't actually enact revenge? What if the person that they're trying to hurt still doesn't care? Mm-hmm. Is it still worth it? Or was it yet another
reactive,
power-seeking move made
petty.
With someone else's emotions as the contingency for her satisfaction?
Yeah.
I am not at all against casual sex, as I do feel it works for some, but that requires maturity and emotional regulation, emotional intelligence first and foremost, to not conflate things like detachment and disrespect.
I put her video in the chat.
Again, stuff like the boss bitch rule book can be very fun to say.
Mm-hmm.
But we cannot get it twisted. This is no political revolution.
Right.
Largely in part because it calls no accountability to men.
It's
have
fun
you
being petty.
The irony?
But it's not healthy.
I've been sitting here talking about this for how long and how many different wigs?
Yeah.
And we ain't talked once about what men are going to do to help us in this fight. Yes.
There is no fight.
We have changed the narrative so that we...
There is no fight unless you belong to a collective. And, like, that's a choice.
We are now the sexual subjects, not the sexual objects. Yes. We have done that. But what's being done on men's side of the seesaw, which is still way high up in the air, might I add, what's being done to make sure that the clear disparity between how men are incentivized for having sex with women versus the cost women have to pay the metaphorical debt, the fucking bankruptcy.
I gotta go
women
faster,
have to enter each and every time we try to take authority over our own pleasure. Are men doing their part in leveling out that imbalance? No. We know the answers. I'm just fucking with you. But if we're gonna call this liberation and a reclamation of power, we should also ask ourselves, are we even requiring that of them? Or are we saying that the ego boost we get from co-opting misogynistic views of sex is good enough? And the opportunity for some of us, a very select few of us, to make money from it is also good enough? Because men ain't hurting from this. They're really not. Not to say that the goal of all this is to make men upset, because I mean, it's a small reward. But that's not like the goal. There may be a few men who disapprove of the hypersexual market, but men's structural power as a whole is not being disrupted just because Megan Thee Stallion is shaking her ass on stage. Men are likely benefiting, because if these performers are influencing a generation of women to say, look, I want it when I want it and I'm gonna get it when I want it and I'm not gonna feel guilty for it, of course men are benefiting, because who the hell else are these straight women having sex with? Lesbians, this is not our time to be funny or cute. And so because of that outcome, which still benefits men but is almost not at all advantageous for women, sometimes I wonder if the purpose of this whole thing to begin with was to seem more appealing to men. No, because I don't want to accept that. I don't want to accept that reality. That makes my chest hurt too much. But it's a possibility, right? Because then why else would we imitate and remix their values, values which are not rooted in women's well-being, but rooted solely in how desirable we are? Coming up in part two.
Okay. Listen. So my brain can process that this is the bubble. And she's saying the men are at the top, and this is the bubble they're going through, right? But when I look at my life and I look at what I'm doing, I feel like I'm in between the bubbles and the world they created, like the rules. So when she was like, what are men doing to fight this battle? What battle, bro? Like, where's the battle? Where's the front lines? Because if you're saying it's in Congress, fuck those people. If it's in our everyday life, it's a matter of women making a stand and like just saying like, hey, I'm just not gonna do that. And also, the only time I'm ever really casual with people during sex is if they are also casual, because most of people, their feelings get hurt and they get involved. It's really hard to have casual sex. Most people can't do it correctly. And by correctly, I mean, negotiate and then, like, do accordingly, right? Don't, like, confuse people. And at the same time, oh my God, I'm getting a headache. This battle that's happening, I still think is kind of made up. Like, it's, like, happening over here, and I'm just like, yeah, but I'm not over there. But everyone's like, the patriarchy's everywhere, so everyone's fighting this battle. But not really. It's like Sneeko and Maria. I love Maria so much. She's so beautiful. Sneeko and Maria were at dinner with Destiny and Melina and everybody and Kyla. And Maria was like explaining how she has a master's degree and this all this education. And they're all like, Sneeko, that doesn't sound like someone you'd be with, right? Sneeko's like, well, she's just smart, man. Like, and they started joking and riffing on like, well, it's not really about gender. And like, that was really cute. I don't know if you guys saw that. They all went to dinner after their Fresh and Fit thing. I really loved watching, because I love Maria, obviously, but like watching her go there, and I know Sneeko in his heart of hearts does not give a fuck about this gender war. He just wants to feel needed, seen, and useful. Like all of us. We want to be seen, and we want to be loved. We want to be understood. We want to be uplifted for who we are as people and not for our fucking gender. So ultimately, when I make love to my partner, I'm making love to them, the consciousness that is them, not their gender. Like I'm in love with the consciousness that is that human. And not like some variation of like, well, he's just a great man who like did everything a man should do. And that's why I'm in love. No, I like the person that is the consciousness that is embodied in this form that I am making love to. Like that is the person I'm in love with. Does this all make sense? Yes. It's not about the gender, which is why those gender abolitionists and all the gender people are fucking confused and retarded. Because again, you guys always say like, I don't judge people on their gender, but as a woman, I'm like, shut the fuck down, you bitch. And so that's what I'm saying. It's not about that. It's about the consciousness. It's a past gender. I'm more progressive than all of you. It's past the construct of gender. It's literally, we're humans. And the consciousness that is this consciousness is the one I love. Beyonce loved the consciousness of Jay, and Jay cheated on her. With Becky and the, just, I can't even, I'm so upset at him still. All these years later, it's not even my business, but I'm still upset with him. Yes, I am. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying at the end of the day, the consciousness is who I'm in love with. You don't give a fuck about your gender. I love you, marry me. Talk to you guys soon. Bye.